I am Sulchana Hazarika, Department of Zoology, DHS, Kanoi College. Now, I am going to present water vascular system of starfish of phylum Echinodermata. Under the initiative of Zoological Society of Assam. The outcome of the present study are what is water vascular system? What are the essential parts of water vascular system and how the locomotion occurs? Water vascular system of starfish. Locomotion to the sister is by means of an entirely new system which is peculiar to the Echinoderm. It is a sort of hydraulic pressure mechanism known as the water vascular system or the ambulacral system. It is a modified part of the coelom and consists of a system of canals lined with a ciliated epithelium and filled with seawater containing certain corpuscles. Its original function was probably concerned with obtaining food. The essential parts of the ambulacral system are the madreporite, stone canal, ring canal, radial canal, tidemen's bodies, lateral canals, and tube feet. Madreporite, the seawater that operates the hydraulic system, enters the water vascular system through the button-shaped madreporite or the madreporic plate. It is a hard, rounded and calcareous plate on the aboreal surface of the central disc of the body. It is situated in an interradial position, that is, between the bases of two of the arms of Byrium. Under magnification, the surface of the madreporite is marked by numerous fine radiating grooves or furrows, bottom of these furrows being perforated by numerous minute ciliated pores, as many as 250, so that the whole plate appears like a sieve or the rose of a watering can. Each pore leads into a small pore canal, passing downward into the substance of the madreporite. The pore canals merge into collecting canals, which converge into a small bag-like space, the ampulla, lying below the madreporite. This is the picture of madreporite. Now the second one is stone canal. The ampulla leads into a vertical S-shaped stone canal or madreporic canal, which opens below by its oral end into a ring canal around the mouth. The stone canal is so named because its walls are strengthened and supported by a series of hard calcareous rings. Its cavity is lined with very tall flagellated or ciliated cells, the movement of which draw water into the canal. Its lumen is occupied by a prominent projection or ridge with spirally rolled lamellae. It divides the lumen of the canal into two passageways so that water may simultaneously circulate orally and aboreally. The stone canal is completely surrounded along with an axial organ by a wide, thin-walled, tubular coelomic sac called the axial shaft, which forms a part of the perihymnal system. This is the picture of section of stone canal. Ring canal. The ring canal is a wide pentagonal or five-sided ring-like canal situated around the mouth just to the inner side of the peristomial ring of ossicles and directly above the outer hyponeural ring sinus. The ring canal gives five radial canals on its outer side. Tideman's body. The ring canal gives off interradially from its medial surface five pairs of small, yellowish, irregular or rounded glandular bodies called racemos or Tideman's bodies. In Asterias, there are only 9 Ted Tideman's bodies. The 10th is absent, which is replaced by stone canal. The function of it is to produce coelomic corpuscles which are passed into the ring canal, and the system is known as water vascular system. Radial canal. From its outer surface, the ring canal gives off 5 long and ciliated radial canals, one entering each arm and lying just dorsal to the corresponding blood vessel and beneath the raster-like ambulacral ossicles. The radial canal runs up to the tip of the arm and terminates as the lumen of a small terminal median tentacle bearing an eye at its base. Lateral canal. In each arm, the radial canal gives off 2 rows of numerous short, narrow, transverse or side branches called lateral or podial canals, those of each side alternately long and short. A lateral canal of one side arises between 2 lateral canals on the opposite side. They pass between the ambulacral ossicles on each side of the groove and enter the coelom. Each lateral canal is attached to the base of a tube foot and is provided with a valve to prevent backward flow of fluid into the radial canal. Pollen vesicles. In most sea stars, the ring vessel also gives off interradially on its outer side a series of elongated pear-shaped muscular sacs with long necks termed the pollen vesicles. They serve as central organs for regulating the pressure in the ambulacral system. They are some sort of lymphatic glands, the lining of which gives rise to the amoeboid cells of the ambulacral system. Tube feet. Each tube foot or podium is a hollow, elastic, thin-walled, closed cylinder. The tip or outer end of podium is flattened, forming a sucker for attachment. Some burrowing species from genera Astropectin and Leudia have blunt points rather than suckers. The inner or basal end of each tube foot pierces the ambulacral ossicle through a tiny ambulacral pore and then expands to form a little rounded bulb or bladder called ampulla lying into the arboreal side of the silo. This is the picture of water vascular system of starfish showing different parts. Locomotion. The water vascular system provides a hydraulic pressure mechanism for locomotion in cisterns. It is filled with a fluid similar to sea water in composition. The beating of the cilia of the ambulacral system causes the seawater to enter through the madreporite. After passing through the stone canal, ring canal, radial canal and lateral canals, it reaches the tube pit and their ampullae. During movement, the podia or tube pit perform a sort of tapping motion. When the sea star wants to move in a given direction, the arm or arms pointing in that direction are lifted. At the same time, the ampullae of the raised arms contract by their circular muscles, thus forcing the water into their tube pit. The valve present in the lateral canals prevents the backward flow of water into the radial canal. As a result, the tube feet are enlarged and extended as far as possible. Successive rings of connective tissue strength prevent lateral expansion of the tube feet. The tube feet become attached to the substratum. On contact with the substratum, the center of the sucker is withdrawn, thus producing a vacuum for adhesion. The tips of the tube feet also secrete a sticky substance for adherence. Now, action of certain muscles in the foot provides a forward thrust of the animal's body. As their longitudinal muscles contract, the tube feet shorten and their water is forced back into their ampullae. As a result, the animal is drawn forward by just the length of its contracting tube feet. Then the suckers relax, the tube feet detach, again extend forward, attach to a new place, and once again contract to bring about slow locomotion. Every time a tube foot contracts, the body is pushed forward. The water from the tube feet is pushed into the ampulla and the tube feet shorten. The suckers are released. Then the ampulla contracts and the whole process is repeated. All the tube feet can perform independently or work in unison in a coordinated manner by extending in the same direction but not at the same time. Consequently, the sea star performs a slow but steady forward locomotion only about 15 centimeters in a minute. The tube feet work in the above described manner when it moves over a hard surface. On a soft mud or sand, the suckers become useless and the animals literally walk, and the tube feet act as little legs. In this way, the hydrostatic movement is done by using hydrostatic pressure and the movement of the starfish occurs. Importance of tube feet. The tube feet also serves as tactile and respiratory organs in some cases. So, apart locomotion, few feet function as feeding and respiration. It also serves for clinging in rocks and for capturing and handling food. Starfish move by clinging in the substratum in water, and they can walk in the land.